alternative news networks were recently awash with a story that declassified documents reveal that tons of nuclear fuel was released from Fukushima, astronomically higher levels than the public had been informed of at the time. At least one mainstream media source covered the story, Russia Today. But is this alarming story true? Let's take a look at the facts. The declassified document in question describes how the Protective Measures Team was refining hypothetical models with which they could determine doses that the public might be exposed to in a worst-case scenario. Right in the paragraph in question, it states that their goal is to refine source-term models. Source-term models are total release models. And you need a source-term model before you can calculate possible doses the public might receive. Sounds like something we hope the government would be doing in the early hours after a nuclear disaster. So the story in the alternative media was a misinterpretation of the features of a hypothetical model as descriptions of what the government knew happened. So let's examine the features of that hypothetical model and look to see if they did happen. The main feature that got headline attention was that Unit 4 spent fuel pool lost 100% of its fuel. Well, did it? Let's take a look at early footage of Unit 4. Here we see the earliest imagery of the demolished Fukushima Daiichi campus, and we can see steam rising from Unit 4, exactly where its fuel pool is located. In other imagery, taken around a month after the disaster, we can also see steam rising from the Unit 4 spent fuel pool. This large green object here is the refueling deck that runs over the pool. And here we see in this footage samples being taken from the water that fills the pool. So where there's steam, there's hot water. And where there's hot water, there's a heat source. So logic dictates that the hot nuclear fuel was still in the spent fuel pool after the disaster, heating up its water and causing it to steam. And in fact, in less than 2 months, TEPCO got a camera into the Unit 4 spent fuel pool and imaged the spent fuel, which we can see here. Not only is the spent fuel obviously not lost to the environment, but it didn't burn in any sense. If the pool had become sufficiently dried, there may have been zirconium cladding fires. But we don't see any signs that there was a fire in the pool. The conditions under there look relatively pristine, apart from some fallen in debris. So as we could logically deduce just from seeing the steam, the fuel was in the pool. That's why TEPCO built a colossal structure around Unit 4, by which to hoist out the spent fuel in the pool. So the visual imagery of what actually did happen is counterfactual to the scenario that Unit 4 lost its fuel. So the scenario described in the declassified document, wherein the Unit 4 spent fuel pool lost its fuel, can't be the truth. A fact-based conclusion we could have as well inferred simply from the declassified document stating that they were developing source-term models, which are hypothetical scenarios. Furthermore, there's no reason to believe that any of the spent fuel pools suffered losses of fuel. The Unit 3 fuel pool has been imaged many times, both from the outside, showing it full of water, and by way of heat-seeking infrared imagery, showing a significant heat source in the pool, the logically obvious source being the spent nuclear fuel, which takes several years to cool. As well, the fuel in Unit 3's fuel pool has also been directly imaged on several occasions, some of which we can see here, where a camera submerged into the pool shows the fuel racks, which apart from being covered with a large amount of debris, are there. They were not blown out. as the heat signature we've seen would suggest. And as for Unit 2, under the hypothetical scenario in the declassified document, it lost 25% of its fuel to the atmosphere. But in reality, Unit 2 did not lose its exterior structure. So it would be difficult to understand how it could have lost 25% of its fuel to the atmosphere through its intact exterior containment. And if we presume that tons of fuel was blasted out its venting window that we see here, the area just outside would be strewn with raw nuclear fuel. It would be so radioactive, nobody would have even been able to get close to the campus. But we can conclude on the Unit 4 imagery alone that the scenario described in the declassified documents would have to be hypothetical, reflecting the described models they were working on.